Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening, welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chanzom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Tuesday, the 20th of October. India's daily COVID-19 cases less than 50,000 for first time in 3 months. Pakistan government decides to go tough on opposition party. And contact groups of Afghan government Taliban discuss disputed issues in Doha. And now for all the details. The air quality in the national capital witnessed a marginal improvement on Tuesday morning due to favorable wind speed. However, it continued to remain in the poor category. A blanket of smoke engulfed the Indian capital, causing breathing difficulties to residents of New Delhi. A blanket of smoke engulfed the Indian capital on Tuesday as air quality dipped, causing breathing difficulties to residents of New Delhi. The US Embassy in New Delhi showed the air quality index at unhealthy category with the reading at 184 at 3:30 GMT. A level of 50 or less is considered safe. According to the Ministry of Earth Sciences, air quality monitors suffer updated at 10:30 AM local time. Several areas in the national capital recorded air quality in the poor category. People who stepped out of their homes to take a walk early in the morning said they could feel the change in the air quality as it was making them feel suffocated.
मैं तो यहाँ रेगुलर वॉकर हूँ लोधी गार्डन में और बिल्कुल ही प्रमेय फैसा ही नोटिस किया है कि यहाँ पर पोल्यूशन के इफेक्ट महसूस होने लग गया है. सांस लेने में भी काफ़ी सफोकेशन सा होता है और जो पहले आज एक महीना पहले जो कंफर्ट लेवल था वो बिल्कुल ही आज नीचे गिर चुका है और इसके लिए हमें बहुत सीरियसली इसको इस इशू को लेना होगा.
आफ्टर मंथ्स ऑफ रिलेटिवली क्लीन एयर बिकॉज ऑफ द लॉकडाउन इम्पोज टू फाइट द वायरस, pollution levels have spiked to their worst in 2 years for October, caused by farmers burning crop stubble in surrounding states and cooler weather.
In the winter season, when there is air quality index is bad, and in this season you see that all the patients of respiratory diseases and cardiac diseases have frequent episodes of decompensation. Mm-hmm. So we expect that air pollution and this coronavirus will be a dangerous combination in winter.
Delhi Environment Minister Gopal Rai earlier on Monday said the odd even scheme will be implemented in the national capital only if rest of the methods to curb air pollution fails. The scheme bans the use of odd cars on even dates and vice versa. The number of new coronavirus infections in India dropped below 50,000 for the first time in nearly 3 months on Tuesday, while 5 most affected states have also seen a decline in the number of cases. Authorities have expressed concern that infections could, however, escalate again due to ongoing festive season and onset of winters.
India posted its lowest daily coronavirus case load with new infections dropping below 50,000 for the first time in nearly 3 months on Tuesday, as new cases maintained decreasing trend from a peak in September. The country reported 46,790 infections and 587 deaths in the last 24 hours, taking its cases tally to nearly 7.6 million and death toll to 115,197. The Health Ministry said on Tuesday that Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, the 5 most affected states, have also seen a decline of active cases since the last 1 month.
इस सप्ताह हमने देखा कि हमारे यहाँ जो recovered cases हैं, उनकी संख्या 67 लाख से अधिक हो गई है. ये विश्व की सबसे बड़ी संख्या है रिकवर्ड केसेस की. हमने इस समय तक 9,60,00,000 टेस्ट किए हैं देश भर में. ये विश्व की दूसरी सबसे बड़ी संख्या है टेस्ट्स की किसी भी देश में.
Though the overall recovery rate is 88.6% and active cases have been on the downslide. Marketplaces are buzzing as the festive season has begun in the country, raising fears about an escalation in cases. Authorities have urged people to follow COVID-19 appropriate behavior during upcoming Dashehra and Diwali festivals, along with winter season, which pose additional challenges in the fight against the pandemic.
In news from Pakistan, amid mounting opposition who have joined hands to oust the incumbent government, Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan has vowed to bring all corruption cases to their logical conclusion, saying that the opposition will no longer get any concessions and lawbreakers will be dealt with strictly.
Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan has vowed to bring all corruption cases to their logical conclusion, saying that the opposition will no longer get any concessions and lawbreakers will be dealt with strictly. While chairing a meeting of the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf Political Committee on Monday, he said there will be no compromise on the rule of law. This comes a day after the 11-party opposition alliance, PDM, Pakistan Democratic Movement, held its second power show in Karachi against Imran Khan's government. Four big opposition parties of Pakistan, the Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz, Pakistan People's Party, the Jamiat Ulema Islam Fazlur and the Pakhtunkhwa Milli Awami Party and some smaller ones have come together to channelize public discontent at rising prices, power cuts and other economic misery. While the campaign to oust Imran Khan, who they accuse of being installed by the military in a rigged election 2 years ago, is underway, his government is likely to have a tough time, as the Global Money Laundering and Terror Financing Watchdog, FATF, Financial Action Task Force, is due to host a virtual plenary between October 21 and 23. The meeting will take a final call on Pakistan's continuation on the grey list after a thorough review of Islamabad's performance in fulfilling the global commitments and standards on the fight against money laundering and terror financing.
Moving on, members of contact groups of Afghan government and the Taliban met on Monday evening as part of continued discussions on the disputed issues in Doha before starting direct peace talks. Despite efforts for peace, violence has continued back home in Afghanistan, which diplomats worry is sapping the trust required for peace negotiations.
Members of the contact groups of Afghan government and the Taliban met on Monday evening in Doha and discussed the disputed issues before direct peace negotiations. Nadir Nadri, a delegate from the Afghan government, informed on Twitter, adding that both sides have agreed to continue the discussion. Taliban spokesperson Mohammad Naeem also confirmed the meeting and said the contact groups, each containing 3 members, discussed controversial points, and the continuation of meetings was emphasized, so a final understanding about the procedure can be reached. The 2 sides have reportedly agreed on 18 out of 20 articles for the procedural rules for talks, but have so far failed to reach consensus on the religious basis and the connection of the US-Taliban deal with the negotiations. Meanwhile, back home, thousands of civilians have been caught up in the fighting between Taliban and Afghan government forces in Helmand province. Diplomats and officials have warned that the rising violence in Afghanistan is sapping the trust required for direct peace negotiations in Doha.
In news from Sri Lanka, Sri Lankan cabinet headed by President Gotabaya Rajapaksa on Monday approved 3 more changes to the proposed 20th amendment to the constitution, which will be debated in the parliament this week. The 20th amendment aims to restore full executive power to the president, and if passed, it would also bring the parliament under the control of President Rajapaksa. The cabinet of ministers in Sri Lanka, headed by President Gotabaya Rajapaksa on Monday afternoon, approved to bring 3 more changes to the 20th amendment to the constitution, which was tabled in the parliament in September. The 3 new amendments include the limit of cabinet to maintain the National Audit Act and to table the emergency draft bills in Parliament 14 days after including in the order paper and the National Security and Disaster Management Bills after 7 days.
Sir,
The previous 19 amendment empowered the parliament and the prime minister, and the 28th amendment aims to restore full executive powers to President Gotabaya Rajapaksa, who would have the power to dissolve the legislature, appoint top judges, and have immunity against any prosecution. The government has agreed to set aside additional 10 hours for parliamentary debate on the 28th amendment to be held on Wednesday and Thursday before a final vote on it this week.
Nepal's main opposition party, Nepali Congress, has hit out the government for its decision not to bear the test and treatment expenses of COVID-19 patients. Calling it a very irresponsible act, the party urged the government to be sensitive and save the public from ongoing COVID-19 pandemic by ensuring free RT-PCR test and treatment to COVID-19 patients.
Nepal's main opposition party, Nepali Congress, on Monday condemned the government's decision not to bear the test and treatment expenses of all coronavirus patients in the country. Nepali Congress spokesperson Bishwa Prakash Sharma issued a press release saying that the government's decision to charge people for COVID-19 test and treatment was an irresponsible act. He stated that the government should shoulder all economic responsibilities, keeping in mind the devastating impact of COVID-19. Amid the continuous surge in COVID-19 cases, Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli's government decided not to bear expenses of all virus-infected people and not to bury infected people who died during home isolation. Meanwhile, Nepal's current COVID-19 tally stands at 136,036. There are currently 40,778 active cases of infection, while 4,470 people are staying at quarantine facilities across the country.
The 9-day religious play of Ram Leela, which depicts the journey of Hindu Lord Prince Ram, is enacted and watched by scores of people across India ahead of Dashera festival. But this year, coronavirus restrictions have forced the play to go online without a live audience.
India's surging coronavirus cases has pushed the festive season to go online, as the traditional annual play of Ram Leela, which is watched with much adoration and fervor across the country, is being performed sans the live audience this year because of the pandemic guidelines in place. Ram Leela tells the journey of Hindu Lord Prince Ram, including his childhood, annihilation of forest demons, his marriage with Princess Sita, her abduction by Demon King Ravan, and the subsequent war to free her and kill Ravan. The Ram Leela Committee in Northern Lucknow City, which has been enacting the play for nearly 600 years, said it was the first time they were going online.
आज तक 600 वर्ष में कभी हमारी रामलीला बाधित नहीं हुई, कभी प्लेग आई, कभी कोई महामारी आई, कभी कुछ हुआ, लेकिन रामलीला का कार्य निर्बाध रूप से चलता रहा है। इस कोरोना संक्रमण में भी जब तक गाइडलाइन नहीं आई, तब तक हम लोगों के भी मन में बहुत तरह के ऐसे विचार बन रहे थे कि कैसे क्या करेंगे हम, अगर करें भी तो यहाँ देखेगा कौन। फिर ऐसा विचार बना कि हम इसको ऑनलाइन करेंगे।
Meanwhile, Ram Leela in Ayodhya, which Hindus believe is the birthplace of Lord Ram, saw Bollywood star power, with veteran actor Govardhan Asrani enacting the role of mythical sage Narad Muni this past weekend. The 9-day play culminates on the 10th day in the festival of Dashera, with the burning of an effigy of Ravan, signifying the victory of good over evil.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude the top stories once again. India's daily COVID-19 cases less than 50,000 for first time in 3 months. Pakistan government decides to go tough on opposition party. And contact groups of Afghan government Taliban discuss disputed issues in Doha. Now our viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com. You can also visit us on Facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter @AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.